بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. All praise be to Allah, the Lord of the heavens and the earth, and peace and blessings be upon our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dear brothers and sisters, I salute you all with the salutation of the people of paradise. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm your host Hatim al-Absalam. Please join us in our program, Knowing Your Religion. We have our distinguished guest with us today, Dr. Sheikh Kahlan bin Nabhan Al-Kharousi, the Assistant Grand Mufti of the Sultanate of Oman. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, Brother Hatim. And I would like as well to welcome all our audience. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. May Allah the Almighty guide us all to the right path, shower our lives with His mercy, and enrich our knowledge in His religion.
Thank you very much, Sheikh, again for being with us. And we really appreciate your valuable time and knowledge and sharing your experience with us throughout this program.
Thank you very much, Brother Hatim. And as I always say, it gives me a great pleasure to be with you, Brother Hatim, and to receive the concerns and questions of our audience and trying to meet their concerns and answer their questions at the best of our level of knowledge based upon evidence derived from the Holy Quran and from prophetic traditions, or through other means of analogy and reasoning, and quoting the opinions of different Muslim scholars on different issues and matters that we receive through this program.
Sheikh, the first question says, can you kindly explain to us the process of divorce, especially when it comes to the period after each divorce?
Right. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. All praise be to Allah, peace and blessings be upon His last messenger. We all know that the end of the contract, the marriage contract between husband and wife, is ended through different ways in Islam. One of them is called divorce, in which the husband is going to pronounce particular sentences or words, and by which the contract is ended. And these words or sentences, some of them are explicit, they are direct, they do indicate that they don't bear any other meaning rather than separation between husband and wife. And because of that, these are the original or the fundamental words used for divorce. And every single language has its particular and definitive words used to indicate this meaning explicitly. There are other ways, other sentences or other words that are not as explicit as the first category. They are implicit. They do mean divorce as they mean as well other meanings. So it is up to the intention of the husband to decide if he, when he pronounced the word of divorce, which is implicit, if he intended to mean divorce, then that's it. That's the end of the contract between them. But if he doesn't intend, if he doesn't mean the divorce, but he is meaning a sound and accepted meaning that the word does accept, then in this case it is not a divorce. And we all know also that there are three chances of divorce in Islam. And after the first two cases of divorce, still the husband has the right to retain back his wife, providing that he will fulfill the condition of having two witnesses at least before touching his wife, before having any marital intercourse. He must bring two witnesses and before them testify that he retains back his wife, and this means that she will remain under his marriage status with two other opportunities of divorce. So he will lose one opportunity and he will retain only two. But the other condition is that this retaining back must be during the period decided and determined in Islam. through which the wife has to remain without being engaged into another marriage to another man. She has to wait for a certain period. She must, and this is a religious act that she must observe. So after divorce, she has to remain for a particular period. And this waiting period is known as عِدَّة. And this عِدَّة varies from one woman to another. It depends on the case. So if she has a monthly period, then until she is purified from the third monthly period, still the husband has the right to retain back his wife by testifying before two witnesses. But if the period ends, then this means that a new contract must be established with all the conditions that we all know about on contract of marriage. If the woman, which is the second category of عِدَّة, the waiting period after the divorce, if the woman is pregnant, then until she gives birth, still he has the right to retain back. Whether this pregnancy period is longer or shorter than the 3 monthly period, menstrual period, it has no effect. So regardless of the length of the period, it doesn't depend on that. It depends on the pregnancy. So let's assume that she is divorced today, and the following week she gives birth. This means that the husband has missed the opportunity to retain back his wife, and they have, if they want, to establish a new marriage contract. The third category is that, let's assume that the wife is not pregnant, and she doesn't have the monthly period. Either she is very old, or due to any illness or disease, so she doesn't, or she is breastfeeding her baby, and very oftenly, mothers at this stage, very often, very common, that they do not have the monthly period. So in this case, it is the period of 3 months that she has to wait until the contract is considered to be ended completely. One of the fascinating rulings about this period is that they are talking about some of the worldly rulings. They are considered husband and wife. So if any of them passes away, then the other party is going to inherit. All conditions of husband and wife are applicable except the marital intercourse. They cannot have any marital intercourse without having this retained back through testifying before the husband, testifying before two witnesses at least, while the wife is still during her period. So this right is also maintained after the second divorce, after the second case of divorce. Still the husband maintains such the right with all the explanations and the conditions that I already mentioned. But after the third opportunity, if he divorces his wife for the third time, then that's it. That's the end of the contract between them, and they are not any longer husband and wife. But she still have to wait for the period, for the عِدَّة, which is the waiting period before getting married to another man. Now, for the first and second time of divorce, I mentioned one of the rulings that are mentioned or associated with this case, in which we can understand that they are husband and wife, except in the matter of having sexual intercourse. So she will remain at his house. As I said, they are both considered husband and wife. In all conditions, all circumstances, if one of them passes away, then the other is considered still the party as they were alive. one of the also rulings about this is that, I mean, when I say that they are considered, they are actually a husband and wife, then this means that all the rights and duties between them still maintained and protected and observed as the contract is valid between them. And the end of this validity is going to be if the period, if the waiting period passes without the husband bringing two witnesses and testifying before them that he has returned back his wife to his under the marriage contract. So I think now this clarifies all sorts of rulings and teachings associated with understanding the cases of divorce between husband and wife. But I already mentioned that the words or statements used to reflect or to indicate the separation between them might be explicit divorce words or implicit, indirect. And here we need to ask the husband about his intention. What did he mean by the word that he used? Because it still can bear the meaning of divorce as it carries also other meanings. Like, let's give the example of I want you out of my life. Now, this can indicate that the man is divorcing his wife, and it could be also meant by him that he's very angry and he doesn't want her to interfere with his private or personal issues. And both meanings are acceptable, but it is his intention which is going, when he declares this statement, it is his intention which will determine whether he means divorce or means something else. But there are other ways of separation between husbands and wives, including what is known as khul'. And the khul' is a ransom, is a compensation paid by the wife to her husband, and in return they will end the contract. And no words of divorce should be associated. And this is very important, because nowadays, even inside courts, husbands are asked to pronounce divorce statements. But there is no need. This makes the issue more complicated. Actually, if she made the offer and he accepts the offer, then that's it. With the witnesses attending this offer and acceptance, then this means that this is an end to the determination for the contract between them. And this is called fidya or khul'. And here it is very obvious that the proposal is made for divorce or for separation is made by the wife and not the husband, because the request is made by the wife. This is another way of divorce, of separation between them. And these are the major or the main ways of separation between man and wife. But in all cases, عِدَّة is required, and عِدَّة means the waiting period, and it varies from one case to another depending on the status of women, whether they are pregnant or they have the monthly period or they do not. So every single case has its own ruling. Allah Ta'ala knows best.
Thank you, Sheikh. The next question says, how does a Muslim perform ghusl al-janaba in an area under freezing conditions?
Well, if they cannot warm up the water, then they are excused. If they cannot, if it is impossible and it is going to negatively affect them, they are excused from making this ghusl, and they can do tayammum or wudu, but they are asked to search for means, for possible means by which it becomes easy for them to use water and to purify themselves, to have the great shower, the ghusl, and then to make wudu and perform their prayer. But if it is impossible and it is going to be harmful for them, it might cause them even death, as it happened during the lifetime of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when the companions, one of them was very sick, and when they asked him to perform the prayer, they insisted on him to have ghusl, and when he made ghusl, he couldn't bear it, and he lost his life. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam blamed them so much, and he explained to them that they shouldn't have done so, because Islam recognizes these unusual circumstances, and as there are these rulings, there are cases of necessities, and this is one of them. So but my advice is that people should not jump to these permissibilities immediately. They should look for solutions first. If there are means to warm up the water, or to heat the water, or to find other place, then that's it. If not, then they can do either just normal wudu, or they can do tayammum. And tayammum is to use earth, if possible, or even just to rub over a stone. And this is sufficient. Allah Ta'ala knows best.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh.
Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un. 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 Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah, inna lillah, inna lillah, inna ilayhi raji'un.
If you have any questions for the show, send your email at k.r@oman-radio.gov.om. At k.r@oman-radio.gov.om. Knowing your religion. Or send SMS to 90406. To 90406. Don't forget to indicate k.r before sending your questions. And for your comments and suggestions, check out our Facebook, Knowing Your Religion. Knowing Your Religion.
Knowing Your Religion. The next question says, a non-Muslim asked me, what do Muslims feel towards non-Muslims? And what does Islam say about non-Muslims?
Well, I think the second question is better than the first one. Yes, they do indicate the same meaning, but it's not a matter of feeling. How do we feel about each other? It is how we relate to each other. How do we behave? And what sort of relationship can we establish? Regardless of our faiths, regardless of our race, regardless of whatever discriminating elements that might be found within our life. So the second part of the question, which is what do Islam say about followers of other faiths, is the right question. And here the answer should be to explain that Islam elevates high human being. regardless of their religion, regardless of their faith, regardless of their color, regardless of whatever, as I said, discriminating elements that might exist between human beings. We all read in the Holy Quran, Allah the Almighty says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَرَزَقْنَاهُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَفَضَّلْنَاهُمْ عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِّمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا تَفْضِيلًا. Now indeed, we have conferred dignity on the children of Adam. So it is not something special for believers. It is not something that is unique for Muslims. It is not something that is only for a certain tribe or nation. It is for all the children of Adam, for all human beings, this human dignity that Allah the Almighty has bestowed over His servants is a comprehensive one. Something that He has honored all human beings with. So they all have this dignity because of their humanity, because of them being created by Allah the Almighty. As I said, regardless of their faith, of their religion, of their color, of their race, of their culture or traditions or place, all these elements have no influence on the fact that all human beings in Islam have been dignified. They have this dignity. Second, they are all made trustees on earth. The concept of trusteeship is again bestowed over all human beings. Allah the Almighty in the Holy Quran says, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةٌ. And now remember when Allah the Sustainer said unto the angels, Behold, I'm about to establish upon earth one who shall inherit it. And this is the concept of trusteeship, of this, of human being being vicegerents on earth. And this is something again that is not only limited for Muslims or for believers or for a certain nation or tribe. It is again a very comprehensive concept in which, under which all human beings are equal, which indicates, of course, a lot of implementations, a lot of meanings associated with this fact, with this concept. When we all share this responsibility associated with the concept of the being dominion over earth, being the creatures that Allah the Almighty has chosen to carry this message, to carry this trusteeship, then definitely this means that we are going to recognize this fact while we are constructing our life and while we are crossing the stages of this world and this life. And even when in the dialogue between the angels and Allah the Almighty, in the same pattern in which He has announced them that He is going to create a dominion, a vicegerent on earth, we can understand this unity of human being before this fact. Because Allah the Almighty says, and I am re-quoting the same verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, verse 30. And remember, your sustainer said unto the angels, Behold, I am about to establish upon earth one who shall inherit it. They said, the angels, Wilt thou place on it such as will spread corruption thereon and shed blood? So their question was about the worst of the acts of human being that they expected, which is to spread corruption and shed blood. On the contrary, they braced themselves with the opposite image. And what they mentioned has nothing to do directly with what they criticized human being with corruption and shedding blood. Because they describe themselves by saying, as Allah is saying in this verse, and I'm quoting, whereas it is we who extol thy limitless glory and praise thee and hallow thy name. So what they mentioned, what they praise themselves with, are indeed acts of worship to indicate that what is going to be the opposite image of corruption and spreading bloodshed is to act on what pleases Allah the Almighty, on worshipping Him alone and remembering and glorifying Him. And again, this fact is not limited to Muslims. So far, let me summarize. I talked at the beginning about how Islam, on the matter of how Islam looks at followers of different faiths, is that we all share the human dignity which Allah the Almighty has bestowed upon us. And then we are all trustees on this earth, which means that we all carry the responsibility of constructing this life and collaborating to establish a system which lead to coexistence and tolerance between people. We all share this responsibility, regardless of our faiths and regardless of our religions. And we do insist and emphasize this fact when we introduce followers of other faiths to Islam. We have to elaborate and explain these facts. The third thing is that we are all created out of the same Father, only one Father. If I may quote again another evidence to indicate or to prove that what I am saying here is not something that I invented to please anybody, but I am relying on authentic sources in the Holy Quran, in which these facts are clearly mentioned and explicitly with no other interpretation than what they indicate here. When Allah the Almighty says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. This verse in the Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah the Almighty says, O men! So here Allah Ta'ala, Allah the Almighty is addressing all men, all human beings. O men, behold, we have created you all out of a male and a female. So this is another fact that we have to elaborate and explain. We all belong to the same origin. We are all belong to the same father, the same mother. As Allah the Almighty says in this verse, behold, we have created you all out of a male and a female. And then another fact, which we need also to emphasize in the same verse, Allah Ta'ala, the verse continues, and have made you into nations and tribes, so that you might come to know one another. So this diversity of life, this variation in creation, is intended for a very noble goal, which is mentioned here, to know each other. And knowing each other here doesn't mean, is not limited to us being introduced to each other, but it means the appreciation and acknowledgement of diversity of life. That we have to appreciate the fact that we are different. There are diversity in life, at all aspects of life, including human being and whatever they choose to commit themselves to or devote themselves for. So this is another fact, that diversity is another recognized fact in Islam. And when we admit this fact, then the ultimate conclusion is that we do appreciate and acknowledge each other, regardless of faith and regardless of religion. But if we are talking about salvation, if we are talking about the hereafter, then again this particular verse explains this fact. It says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. The noblest of you in the sight of God is the one who is most deeply conscious of Him. Behold, God is all-knowing, all-aware. And what we notice here, Brother Hatim, is that when it comes to talking about the life to come, the life after the Day of Judgment, the hereafter, And about salvation, Allah the Almighty says that the variation between you is not on your side, it is on side of God. Which means that salvation is on the side of God, of the Almighty, of Allah the Almighty. So we are not responsible for the salvation of others. We are responsible for our own salvation. We are responsible for our own destiny. And we have to understand this fact, that we are not judges on this life. We are obedient to Allah the Almighty. We are servants to Allah the Creator, our Lord. And we are responsible and accounted for our own actions and our own deeds. Yes, part of this accountability is to introduce others who are ignorant or illiterate or unknowing to the right path. To introduce this path to them. Otherwise, and this is the final fact that I'm going to elaborate, which is again mentioned clearly in the Holy Quran, لا إكراه في الدين. There is no compulsion on religion. No one can force others to accept and follow a particular faith or religion. Again, and as I said, I am here quoting another famous verse in the Holy Quran, when Allah the Almighty says, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي. O man, Allah the Almighty says, there shall be no compulsion in matters of faith. Distinct has now become the right way from the way of error. Hence, he who has rejected the powers of evil and believes in God has indeed taken hold of a support most unfailing, which shall never give away, for God is all-hearing, all-knowing. Now, I may conclude that after all these facts, then comes the issue of relationship. How can we engage with each other? How can we deal and behave towards each other? Again, we find many sacred texts in the Holy Quran teaching us that establishing peace and insisting on the maxim of coexistence and tolerance between people is one of the noble goals of Islam. It is one of the highest, actually, aims of establishing religion on earth. It is to provide people with this comprehensive pattern of coexistence between people. And if I may quote a verse from the Holy Quran in which Allah the Almighty is explaining this fact, then it becomes very clear for us that the sort of relationship we should establish and the our behavior towards each other should be based upon this principle, which is clearly mentioned in the Holy Quran when Allah the Almighty says, لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم إن الله يحب المقسطين. As for such of the unbelievers as do not fight against you on account of your faith and neither drive you forth from your homelands, God doesn't forbid you to show them kindness and to behave towards them with full equity and justice. For verily God loves those who act equitably. I think this is the main principle that we should adhere to. And we should also introduce others too. Yes, if we are talking about those who declare wars against us, then in this case, it is an unusual circumstances. And we are asked to fight back. And for those who are oppressing their people or who are practicing tyranny, then Allah the Almighty has asked us to enjoin good and forbid evil as one of the duties and responsibilities of Muslims. Otherwise, the maxim that we should follow is this one which is mentioned in this verse. And I do not got any sort of reluctance to re-quote the verse. It is in Surah Al-Mumtahana. Allah the Almighty says, as for such of the unbelievers as do not fight against you on account of your faith, and neither drive you forth from your homeland, God does not forbid you to show them kindness and to behave towards them with full equity. I think if we adhere to these main principles, these maxims of justice, equity, and kindness, and introduce others to these maxims and these principles, then we are going to spread the right message of Islam. And let me, Brother Hatim, and I'm sorry if I take more than I should on this question, but it is one that I like very much, and it is a fascinating issue. But let me quote another verse in which one might, because I mean, I know that we do have different audience of different backgrounds, and unfortunately nowadays, Muslims and Islam, there is a distorted image, a very distorted stereotype image about Islam and Muslims being doing extremist acts and committing violence. Yet this is not part of the teachings of Islam, but this doesn't mean that Muslims are not allowed to fight back or to spread the message of their religion in the ways allowed and mentioned or determined in the Holy Quran. But as a fact, when I said that the relationship between Muslims and others should be based upon peaceful relationship, I think this is very much derived from a very explicit verse in the Holy Quran when Allah the Almighty says, وَإِنْ جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَاجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. But if they incline to peace by showing any sign, I mean the word in Arabic indicates that if they show any sign of inclining to peace, then incline thou to it as well, and place thy trust in God. Verily, He alone is all-hearing, all-knowing. So this is the main principle. Even at times of wars or conflicts, this is the main principle. You have to follow all the means and all the signs that will bring you back to peaceful coexistence. I think this is the what we need to understand about Islam. But when it comes to salvation and the Day of Judgment and what happens next, then it is in the hands of Allah the Almighty. No one can guarantee his own destiny, let alone others. And that's what we should focus on, our own destiny, our own salvation, including, of course, guiding others, showing them, introducing them to the right path. Allah Ta'ala knows best.
Barakallahu fiqh, Sheikhi. Thank you so much for elaborating regarding this question. It's a very, very important question, and you have put it in a very nice way and very systematically understood.
Astaghfirullah wa natubu ilayk. 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 Astaghfirullah.
أستغفر الله ونتوب إليك أستغفر الله ونتوب.
If you have any questions for the show, send your email at k.r@oman-radio.gov.om at k.r@oman-radio.gov.om knowing your religion, or send SMS to 90406 to 90406. Don't forget to indicate k.r before sending your questions. And for your comments and suggestions, check out our Facebook knowing your religion.
We go to the next question, Sheikh.
Yes.
The question says, can you kindly explain to us the Islamic ruling on children's custody when parents are divorced?
Okay. The right forward answer is, it should be, the custody should be for the mother unless she got married to another husband. So this is the general principle. Providing that they are still children, and now this is determined by the constitution as to be less than 7 years, to be younger than 7 years. So the custody should be for the mother. The maintenance should be paid by the father, but the custody is for the mother. After the age of 7, and this is actually the law here is based upon juristic Islamic law, which says that children can be asked if they are capable enough. So they can choose themselves whether they are going to be with their mother or with their father. They can be asked. And of course, the point here is to look after the children, what is best for the children. And both parents should focus on this as well. They should search, because no one can eliminate the status of the other. They are both parents. For the woman, she is the mother. And for the man, he is the father of the children. So they have to look for what is best for their children. Are the circumstances and the sphere would enable the mother to look better after the children and to raise them in accordance to what is better and what is for their interest, or it is with the father? But if we are talking about a conflict and issues that cannot be settled except through judiciary, then this is the ruling. Allah Ta'ala knows best. Of course, if they become mature and after the age of puberty, then it is up to the boys and girls to decide.
Sheikh, what happens after the age of 7?
The children are going to be asked whether they want to remain with their current custodian or they want to be transferred to the other, to their father or mother.
And what about the maintenance that you spoke about?
Yes, this is going provides. To be determined. Yeah, it has to be determined either through settlement between parents or through court. But because, as I said, this is a relationship that cannot be disconnected. I mean, the fatherhood and motherhood, then it is their liabilities. Every single one of them has liabilities towards the children, and it is up to the fathers to maintain their children. But if it was part of a settlement, of an agreement between fathers and mothers, between the father and the mother, then in this case, this can be accepted and recognized as a sound settlement between them.
Sheikh, the settlement, does it include food, drink, and shelter? Or does it include other things?
In the calculation, yes. Even the expenses of schooling, as an example.
Mm.
So, what is going to maintain a good living for the children? Because they have to be looked after and they have to be maintained. As the family is still, as the relationship between their mothers, their mother and their father is still valid and sound. So the separation between their parents should not influence their status. And this is when I said the great emphasis should be given. If the separation takes place, then the concentration should be on how to raise up the children in a healthy environment. And here, It's either the both father and mother should sit down and sort out all these issues and reach a conclusion of settlement, or it should be even by consulting wise members of their families. If they cannot achieve this settlement, then it has to go through court. Allah Ta'ala knows best.
Thank you, Sheikh.
حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل 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 حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل
If you have any questions for the show, send your email at k.r@oman-radio.gov.om at k.r@oman-radio.gov.om Knowing your religion. Or send SMS to 90406 to 90406. Don't forget to indicate K.R. before sending your questions. And for your comments and suggestions, check out our Facebook, Knowing Your Religion. Knowing Your Religion.
Knowing Your Religion. The next question says, I entered the masjid late and missed the congregational prayer, so I had to pray alone, and after reciting Al-Fatiha, a group entered the masjid and started to perform prayers in a congregational. Should I leave my prayer and join them?
Yes, one should leave his prayer and join the congregation, but it depends. If he is in a place where he is, as an example, standing, and he thinks that they are commencing their prayer, the congregational prayer, then he can finish the rak'ah and then join them.
So providing should he do that, the salam, Sheikh?
Yes, with the salam. But this means even if he leaves the prayer to join the congregational prayer, then he can leave the prayer without the salam. He can, but it is better to make the salam. As I said, providing that he thinks, and there are either signs or whatever evidence that they are performing that particular prayer that he is performing. There is an exception of travelers who are traveling alone in mosques by the road, and people are going and coming, and congregations are established one after another. So in this case, this is an exceptional status, and he is allowed not to leave his prayer, because he is uncertain about this congregation, whether they are performing the same prayer or one that they have missed or one that he has missed or whatever. As I said, it is a mosque of travelers mostly. Then this can be recognized. Otherwise, originally, or the right action to be done is that he should leave his prayer and join the congregation, because it is a must, and this is based upon an authentic hadith in which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا أُقِيمَتِ الصَّلَاةِ فَلَا صَلَاةَ إِلَّا الْمَكْتُوبَةِ. Once the prayer is called for through the iqama, then there is no other prayer except that of the congregation. So this opinion is based upon this authentic hadith. Of course, there are minor opinions of some scholars who claim that if he has entered his prayer by pronouncing the takbir, then it is not a must to leave his prayer. It is preferred. But the first opinion is the correct opinion. Allah Ta'ala knows best.
Sheikh Kahlan, we cannot thank you enough for your time and your knowledge. And we hope, inshallah, we can sustain this and continue with the program with further more questions and to share your experience with the audience.
Thank you very much, Brother Hatim.
Dear listeners, I'm your host, Hatim Al-Absalam, signing off for today. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.